Right, so we're back in part two to look at the BTC3100 battery charger. What we're going to do, we're going to open it up. This is basically just to check the build quality. I'm certainly not very familiar with the internals of a battery charger, but we might be able to have a look at the build quality, the soldering and what have you, and make a judgment call on how well it's actually put together. Right, so there we go, literally just four self-tappers in the bottom. Has to be set also nice little feet, so it's nice and stable when you do put it on a surface. That's also nice and straightforward, comes off very easily. Interesting. There's this tape, which is taped over the air slots over there. What is that all about? So it's literally like electrical tape. I'm not sure why they would want that put over there, where there is an issue. But nonetheless, okay, so that's there. Right, so we've got the internals of the actual charger itself. Here are these slots where you actually insert these cells. I've noted that on the springs, they've got a Celastic on the top of the kind of spring to make sure that it doesn't spring off the kind of catch point. There are four inductors on each of the kind of charge channels with a few electrolytic capacitors. At the bottom of the board, I've noted there's a couple of electrolytic capacitors. What looks to be probably a voltage regulator of sorts, I'm assuming. There's an IC here with no markings at all, and then obviously this glob over here, which must be the main processing unit, which obviously controls the intelligence of the actual unit itself. Then further up the board, we get surface mount components. There are resistors, some diodes, and then the switch on the side over here. Now, Kreisel did mention to me that there was a switch inside. Now, it's got a setting of 4.2, 4.35, and 3.7. So that may allow for some other chemistry type. So you can set the top charge voltage, which could be quite interesting and handy. I didn't see mention of this in the instruction manual itself. Then at the top, we've got this little plug over here, which is obviously the connection for the fan. What I'll do next, I'll remove the few other screws in the circuit board to see if there's anything on the other side of interest. Right, so I've gone and removed all nine. There are nine screws actually supporting the or holding the PCB down into the actual charger casing. It kind of makes sense. You've obviously got a fair bit of mechanical movement with the fairly strong springs. So you want to make sure that it is held down very well, which is what they have done. The next little challenge is as I want to take it out, the LCD and buttons are obviously coming out. That's mounted on the actual PCB on the other side, but I need to carefully detach the springs because that's holding it in from the sliders. Okay, I thought there might be a bit more drama involved with that, but that was fairly straightforward. No, there's still something else that's preventing me from releasing it. Interesting. So the springs themselves are actually held on these little pins, captive pins. I thought the pins were actually secured in there, but they're obviously just in a hole in the PCB and held in by the bottom of the case. So that's fairly straightforward. Okay, so challenge, what's holding it in is these contacts at the top of the actual charger now. There we go, just a little gentle pressure on the contacts, and that's coming out. Let's undo the fan. The inductors, no, some very fine wiring, which is going to some Celastic. Those wires, that's thermal attachments. Okay, that might provide a little challenge. Let's see how far we get. Okay, it's rather tricky. Just want to be very careful. So there's the other side of the board, and as you can see there, those little fine wire attachments which are celasticed into the top of where the actual cells would sit in their slots. And I'm assuming those are thermal thermal measuring devices, which obviously measure the temperature at the top of each cell, and that would probably actuate then the actual fan itself. But let me see if I can get this on the bench and we can have a closer look. Right, so here you go. There are those little fine wires with the connectors. Again, some surface mount bits and pieces there. They've actually got something on the top of the IC packages. We'll see if we can have a closer look at that and identify those. Looks like there's some transistors, resistors. Are there any capacitors and then the IC packages for each of the channels? We've then obviously got the contact which the bar slides up and down on. These have now come out, but they obviously make contact there. And then we've then got the actual LCD display with the actual momentary switches, which are down here. The actual LCD display, as you can see, is mounted. It's got these connectors coming up. It's nice and sturdy on the board. Certainly no concern with the robustness there. Two of the screws I took out, in fact, hold that, but it's soldered on with those connectors, and then it's got the zebra connector going through to actual PCB itself. Right, so I brought in my other camera for a closer look, and there's obviously, that's a transistor. We've got some resistors, some capacitors, and then this package in the middle, and I'm just going to see if I can make out what it says on there and if I can identify it. Right, I'll just bring you in for another view of that IC so you can actually see the identification. So it says 323S1 and P3484, and I unfortunately in my search cannot find anything related to that. So I could be very well not just turning up the right results, not looking in the right database. But if you do find what that is, please post what it is below and where you found it, because that would be really handy. Right, another fun task of getting it back together and still keeping it in one piece. Wow, this is a delicate procedure with these little wires and trying to keep those little pieces of the slot sliders in place. Right, I've got it back together. I started screwing some of the screws in the corners here, but obviously that's for the ones which finally close the actual case itself, so it was my mistake. They are very small screws going into plastic, self-tappers. Most of them went in fine. The ones which are going into the display obviously went in very solidly. I will note that one of them in particular was turning, so obviously you have to be very careful with these small screws going, self-tappers going into plastic. The one thing that did catch my eye that I didn't see initially on the board was this little component over here. And that, I think, and someone correct me, but I wonder if that is a crystal. It does mention C31, but I think that's on that little surface mount there. So I'm wondering whether that's a little timing crystal, a little clock. And of course, there was a little bit of forethought there with that design for the spring and the actual pin. I was trying to get these back in with the pin nose pliers, but of course, you don't need to. You can simply remove them, slot it in, and then put the pin back in the board. Right here, that's all back together. Mustn't forget the fan. They seem to have a little bit of rubber here just to securely mount the fan. I must say the fan seems to be nice and secure with a little bit of springiness to it, perhaps to prevent the vibration transferring to the actual case itself. So there you go, it's back together. I have noted though that this one slider over here is a bit stiff, and I do believe that's because of the way I tightened the board back down. So obviously during assembly, they need to be fairly careful in terms of the way that's put on. It does spring back all right. Let's see if I can fix that. And there you go. It was literally just releasing a little bit of pressure on this one over here. Obviously that was just, it was pulling it too tight and preventing the slider from moving freely. No problem now. Right, so the main test, let's make sure it does power back on. Yep, let's make sure it sees a battery, or a cell, I should say. I keep on saying battery when I should be saying cell. It sees it, and it's starting its automatic charge. It's voltage. There we go, it's clocking up. It's clocking up the milliamp hours and the time. No problem. Right then, so first off, a big thanks to Kreisel for sending this to me for review. He said, hold no punches, throw it against the wall. I wasn't intending to throw it against the wall. But Kreisel and other folks are now religiously going into a lot of detail with reviewing these kind of chargers. Certainly not my forte, little round chargers like this, but hopefully there's enough information there to give you some insight to it. I will post a link down below to someone who's got a written blog where I said they went into some detail using an oscilloscope to kind of measure the outputs. So there's some more detail there. I know Kreisel also mentioned someone that he knows will be selling one of these. Now I went to the link prior to producing this video and it wasn't operating, but I will email him and I'll post a link below if it is working. But I will certainly be using this to charge my batteries in the future. I'm very chuffed with the features and what have you. It is the first iteration. I think there might be iterations to come, but certainly there's a few technical things there. The fan going pulsing on and off, I think if it was more consistent. The voltage reading seemed to be okay. The current readings seem to be out of whack. I actually just went and checked my meter now before I started filming to make sure it was within calibration. No problem there. So the current readings seem to be a bit out. Will that actually upset the working and the way it operates? As long as the internals are actually accounting for the consumption, the milliamp hour consumption, then that should be fine. That is something I certainly didn't go into detail and check to do a comparison of the milliamp readings, and that may be something I do offline and then post something about later. But anyway, thank you very much. I hope you gained some value from that. If you do, then certainly give the video a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.